So welcome everybody to this afternoon. We are from Endoscopy on Air on behalf of Professor Alessandro Repici. I'm happy to welcome you for a satellite symposium sponsored by Fujifilm. The main topic is EUS, and we are very much looking forward to watch the development EUS has taken in the last years, a lot towards therapeutics. We have an excellent faculty, and I think we'll be starting with a trailer and an introductory video. We go straight into the agenda. And one of my partners this afternoon is Julio Iglesias Garcia from Spain, who has been an integral part of the big EUA event for many years. And he's in charge of live cases, of lectures, and of polls. And Julio, please explain us what we are going to do this afternoon.
Okay, thank you, Thomas, so much for the introduction. First of all, I would like to thank Endoscopy on Air, because it's really been a change in the management of endoscopy and the way to teach endoscopy. So thanks, Thomas and Alessandro, that you are the fathers of this idea, which has been really a step forward in endoscopy. And for this specific event, I want to thank Fujifilm for the support, and also for the big effort that they are doing to try to increase the quality on endoscopy and in my field, my specific field, the role of endoscopic ultrasound. The idea of the agenda of today is to try to share with the audience what are the new innovations that AUS is arising and that we have available today, many of them based on Fujifilm support. So we will try to have a couple of lectures to try to set which is the situation. But I think the most important part of this event is the live cases. So we want to translate from a small theory to the big central event, which is show you live what is the opportunities that AUS and now the new systems that Fujifilm is providing us, what is going to be the future, and what do we believe is the future for AUS. For me to be chaired by Thomas, which is one of the biggest KOLs in the field of AUS, is a real pleasure. So thank you, Thomas, for the opportunity to be and to share with me this this event. So the idea is to start with a small talk with the situation of the new technologies based on diagnostic AUS. Then we will go for a couple of live cases. Then we will have an overview about what is going on therapeutic AUS, to end with a couple of new live cases, and to end with a nice discussion on our beliefs as experts, but also with our big expertise in teaching and what are we our thoughts talking and discussing about our thoughts on the future of AUS. So thanks again, all the team, also the IT team from Endoscopy on Air, which is excellent and very easy to work with them. So Thomas, I give you the word to keep on the introduction. And again, thank everyone for their support for this. I'm sure it's going to be a very exciting event.
Thank you. I can only return my gratitude to you for setting up this meeting. In fact, life is an integral part of Endoscopy on Air, and a hallmark of the big event as well as the satellites. And if I'm informed correctly, Julio, you will give us some introduction on the fundamentals of EUS. What's the basis for what we are going to see later in the afternoon live, and then some lectures?
So I hope now you can very nicely see my screen.
Everything so good?
Okay. So my idea is to share with you in very briefly, because I don't want to take a lot of time in lectures, but I think it's very nice to have a little idea on the fundamental of the US, the current standard of care, and also an insight on what is the access to training, how we can be trained a little bit in all of this fantastic technology. So just to start, it's very important for you to know that there has been a great evolution and a great development in the field of AUS. Just to let you know, AUS started, the first ever publication was from CIVAC in the 1980s. I think it was in the 1987. And just to put you in idea on the timing, in 1986, it was the first ever movie of Top Gun. Just remember that in 2022, where we are now, we have the new Top Gun Maverick. So you can see how Tom Cruise has evolved and the evolution of EUS are a bit the same. And just to have an idea on the change in technology, in 1986, Maradona scored the goal with the hand. And today this would be absolutely impossible, or at least it would be somehow impossible because now we have the bar. So that's an idea how technology has evolved over the years, and it's exactly the same, the evolution of endoscopic technologies, and it's the evolution of endoscopic ultrasound. So in fact, if we want to highlight what have been the main points for the evolution of AUS that started in the 80s with the radial AUS, you need to know that the first linear AUS make a big change, and this was developed in 1992, together with FNA. And we all remember that the first ever guy to do a puncture, AUS guided, was Peter Billman, and the publication is coming from the 1991, if I remember well. Then we keep moving with the evolution of the devices to AUS. So we start to do real therapeutic AUS, and now it is very clear that we can access almost every place and we can do any kind of drainage, and we are starting to do a guided therapy. But with the evolution of the technology, we are moving also to advanced imaging, and we are moving to the possibility not to do cytological evaluation of the lesions, but with the possibility to do real biopsies. And somehow this is how we have evolved over the years. And in this moment, we are rising the time of advanced imaging, FMB, and more advanced therapeutic AUS. So when we talk about this idea, what do we expect, or what do we really need? So I think there is two main roles for endoscopic ultrasound. For me, the biggest one is still the diagnostic possibilities that this fantastic technique is providing to us, but also we are an increased number of new therapeutic alternatives, new therapeutic opportunities that I'm sure that Andreas Anderloni, Professor Anderloni, is going to explain in the next lecture, that we will focus in therapeutic AUS, because now I think we are going to focus on diagnostic AUS. And when we talk about diagnostic, the first idea that it comes to our mind is, oh, okay, Julio, but what are the real indications of AUS in 2022, 2023, that is in the moment we are living now? And what I just try to summarize very briefly and just in one image to show you that the number of indications according just to clinical practice guidelines this year is increasing a lot. And the number of accepted indications in which we can place AUS in the top of the indications is really increasing, and is really very, very high. And just to let you know, and to bring you really information summarizing in just one slide, that I just try to place all the accepted indications. I think all of us today think in the US, whenever we need to do a tumoral staging of a luminal cancer, talking about esophageal cancer, gastric cancer, rectal cancer, gastric lymphoma, but also a key tool for the evaluation of subepithelial lesions, now is becoming more and more important. And today we are going to see from Santiago a very nice case on liver disease indication, because I can introduce a little bit that we are going to do a liver biopsy, but it's also critical for the evaluation of enlarged lymph nodes, both from the mediastinum, but also intra-abdominal lymph nodes from the upper part to the perirectal area that we can access by AUS. And probably the main indication of AUS that we all know is the pancreatic biliary diseases. And this is coming from the evaluation of pancreatic solid and cystic lesions, evaluation of chronic pancreatitis, all of the biliary tree, stones, tumors, cystic pancreatic lesions. And this is a field that is never stops growing. And finally, an indication that is very much linked to EBUS is the opportunity to reach mediastinal diseases. Among them, the most important one is lung cancer. But just believe that these indications placed in this slide are all accepted according to the clinical guidelines and the state of the art of all of the different societies that are involved in this type of diseases and this type of lesions. But what is important is this is arising because we have an increased diagnostic capabilities based on AUS. And now we have the possibility to evaluate the stiffness of the tissues based on real-time elastography and shear wave elastography. But we also have the possibility to do an evaluation of the vascularization. And we are all aware of the contrast enhanced harmonic AUS. But we have brand new technologies coming with Fujifilm new systems, which is the detective flow imaging, the DFI. And of course, we can put the needle wherever we can reach with the scope. And now we have the possibility to obtain real histological pathological samples, mostly with the new crown needles, providing a lot of good tissue that is going to, for sure, make a change in the management of many diseases. But in this field, and this is an insight to Fuji, and thanks for the big effort of this company trying to provide us, the users, with the best technology, now we want to show you which is the combination of the new EUS scope, which is the premium lineup, the new, brand new, the EG740 UTA, that is now possible to be connected to the Arieta 850, which is really providing, believe me, real amazing images. It's a very nice scope. We will see the scope used live. That is the best moment to see what is the advantages. But just believe me, that this combination with the 740 UTA together with the Arieta 850 is providing probably one of the top images in the field of endoscopic ultrasound. Of course, we have some additional other good scopes that also are providing very nice imaging, also with the possibility to be connected to the Arieta 850. Remember that this system is available for all of the different scopes company. And also, Fuji is providing a compact system that I think is a very good indication to have in the ERCP room to perform these combined therapeutic AUS procedures. So thanks to this scope, we have really a step forward, because there's a different design in terms of the crystals for the ultrasound images. That is the possibility to be able to obtain the best elasto image together with the best DFI, the best content enhancement. And you will see, better than an explanation, on theoretical explanation, you will see all of the possibilities of this therapeutic scope that we are even also capable to do an almost a standard gastroscopy, even to be able to do a retroflexion during the procedure. So of course, when we have this very advanced technology based on the new 850 with all of the huge processor, with the latest version of the crystals as adapted to the tip of the scope, we have an improved B-mode imaging. You will see what I'm meaning about high resolution, tissue harmonic, e-focusing, combined imaging. At the end, this is a concept that lead to a final result, which is a better B-mode, better contrast, less pixel image, higher resolution, providing much, much better imaging. So it is going to improve our capability to diagnose and make our life as endosonographers easier. But of course, the next step is the possibility to do advanced imaging. And this is elastography. In the two ways of doing elastography, you know that we have the strain elastography that is going to evaluate the relative stiffness of tissue by its response to compression. So this is going to be translated into color patterns that you already, I'm sure you know. So hard is usually blue, soft is usually red, and in the middle, we have the green colors. And this can also be measured with the strain ratio and the strain histogram. But now we have also available in this system the possibility to perform a shear wave elastography, because shear waves are generated using a push pulse to excite the tissues. And shear wave assess tissue stiffness by calculating the shear wave speed propagation of the tissue. That's the velocity. But and also is going to provide information on the elasticity value. So we are going to obtain the kilopascals. This is very much close to what we are doing with the FibroScan that is very widely used in the evaluation of liver diseases. So this is brand new, the shear wave, and we are still working, trying to optimize how to do the technique AUS guided. But it's very promising, believe me, that is very promising. And in the other hand, we know that elastography is a very well-established technique in many different indications for the evaluation of solid lesions and also for inflammatory process, for instance, in chronic pancreatitis. But also, again, we have the possibility with this advanced imaging, and this is very important because Fujifilm 850, the Arieta 850 is providing the possibility with the e-focusing. So we do contrast enhancement with e-focusing that is going to reduce the focus dependency for contrast echo, delivering a more clear image. And with the carbine imaging together with the e-focusing, we are going to have even more quality image according to the previous B-mode. But it's not only that we are going to have the pattern, like we can see in this video when we are facing, in this case, a pancreatic lesion, but we have also available in the 850, in the Arieta 850, we have the possibility to do the quantification of the uptake of software. So it is not going to be only what we see, but also what we calculate. And you can very nicely see in the video that the quality of the contrast enhancement that we are obtaining with the combination of the 740 together with the Arrieta 850 is really outstanding. So it's really going to increase our diagnostic capabilities. But now we have some brand new techniques today, which is the detective flow imaging. This is really new. It's a couple of publications coming from Yamashita from Japan, that this is a new imaging technology for the visualization of low velocity blood flow. So this is for the evaluation of microvascularization. So many times this is not considered with the conventional methods, but it is true that with this unique algorithm displays fine blood flow, so we are really going to have a great sensitivity, great resolution to be able to obtain how this microvascularization within the lesions are. And this is very much what we see when we administer the contrast agent, but without the need to inject any contrast imaging. And here you can see, for instance, how we can very nicely see in this video the microvascularization corresponding to this liver lesion, providing with a lot of information on the differential diagnosis of many different diseases. Just to give you an overall example of what we can do with all of this advanced imaging, from the new B-mode to all of these techniques, I just brought an example from our center of a pancreatic cancer. So we can have a very nice evaluation of B-mode. We can have a very extraordinary evaluation of the microvascularization with the DFI. And you can very nicely see in this image that this is a no uptake. So it's the same as an hypovascular lesion that we can very nicely see, for instance, in this contrast enhancement evaluation. But we can also perform a shear wave elastography of this lesion. We can also do a real-time elastography, in this case, evaluating the strain histogram, for finally being able to perform an EUS-guided tissue acquisition that we can guide according to the different images. Because many times when you have this advanced imaging, our life to perform an FNA or an FNB is easier, because we can try to direct the needle to the right place inside of the lesion to try to optimize our diagnostic yield. So it's really just an example of how advanced imaging can improve our capability in differential diagnosis and also to improve the management for the final diagnosis, in this case of a solid pancreatic lesion, that I can tell you that the final diagnosis in this case was a pancreatic adenocarcinoma. But it's also very important that all of these techniques that are very good, of course, need to be trained. Fortunately, now the ESGE is really helping a lot, trying to state which is the curriculum, on which is the way we need to learn to do an EUS, and of course, the way we need to learn of this advanced imaging and advanced EUS. So now, and this, I want to thank the ESGE, I want to thank all of the international societies. In this sense, Endoscopy Unit is providing a huge opportunity to all of the people to try to learn, because this learning is based in virtual reality, mechanical simulators. We need to learn the system. So this is great that, for instance, companies as Fujifilm is helping taking the doctors to the key centers that we can teach on how to use and how to learn to use all of these complex computers, because we can go to hands-on basic EUS for imaging and for advanced imaging. We can go to simulators and ex vivo or on in vivo for tissue acquisition. I'm going to focus on diagnostic. Of course, there's more and more formal courses to complement training, and there is more and more textbooks, guidelines, e-learning, video cases, congresses, but mostly live endoscopy workshops and live streaming workshops like this one that is going to be a big help to try to increase our capabilities in doing an EUS. And of course, we are a lot of centers with a lot of interest in teaching and making a stage in a hands-on in referral centers. It is always one of the best opportunities to try to increase your capabilities in doing a good EUS. And not to take more time, because again, I think the best part of these events are the live sessions. Brief take-home messages to all of us that are listening to these fundamentals on EUS and teaching. I think endoscopic ultrasound is an amazing technique. I really believe. I will love to hear Thomas, for instance, with his huge expertise on what's his impression on endoscopic ultrasound, because he's been from the very beginning. This technique is very useful in many and multiple different clinical scenarios, and these scenarios are really increasing every day because there is a continuous evolution in indications and in techniques. And of course, for this, one of the key points is improved imaging, both in ultrasound and endoscopy, because it makes our life much easier. And new high-quality B-mode adding advanced imaging provides the perfect scenario. And this is real-time elasto, shear wave, contrast enhancement, DFI, anti-shear excision. And nothing more. I think, again, thank you for your attention. I hope I just take your interest a little bit more in EUS and all that we have in the future. And I think now we have the time for the poll. I think I'm going to stop sharing my presentation. Thanks, Thomas, again for the introduction and the opportunity. And I don't know if you want to make any comment, because any comment coming from you in the field of EUS is of huge interest to all of us.
Yeah, thanks very much, Julio. You are such an enthusiast. So if you don't know anything about EUS after your lecture, you just start running and do it. I was really pleased to see, you know, in 86 with the hand of God and Mike Sivak and all what happened. A little bit philosophically, you know, we started with diagnostics and staging. And I sometimes feel sorry, you know, in the era of multimodal treatment and the necessity to really differentiate between T2, T3, we have lost staging a little bit and have not scientifically worked about improvement. So what's your personal opinion? What should we do? Do you think we should take the diagnostic part back just beyond the pancreas, the luminal part?
I am a big believer, Thomas. In fact, I can tell you that in my unit in Santiago, we are still doing as a routine for the staging esophageal cancer and gastric cancer mainly. And a lot of times we provide some information that CT, even the latest version of the multi-detector CT scan, or even MRI, are not really so good, for instance, to distinguish between T1, T2, sometimes for the evaluation of T4 on how far, for instance, a gastric cancer is infiltrating, is key information for the surgeon. But it is not the same the amount of liver that is the tumor is infiltrating, or if the tumor is really going into the pancreas or not, because the surgery is completely different. And I think many times CT scan, even multi-detector CT scan, it is not as good as AUS in expert hands. So to answer in that question, Thomas, yes, I think for a staging gastric cancer and non-stenotic esophageal tumors, I think there is still a key role of AUS, because it can really guide the best treatment for those cases.
I absolutely agree. And I think that's an important message of that session. Don't forget the origins. Don't forget diagnostics. But on the other hand, I think we have to do a little bit more research on the, you know, to improve the well-known difficulties like, you know, inflammation versus cancer, T2, T3, lymph node diagnosis. Maybe we have been a little bit lazy with that, but that's also a plea from my side to intensify the work in this area. And because nowadays people mostly want to put a needle in things and do therapeutics, but the imaging part is still important. And there's one question from the audience with regards to imaging, which goes along the same lines, puncture and intervention. So what's the role of radial? Should everybody just learn linear? And it's an old question, but it's still valid.
Okay. For me, the radial is the best scope for the museum. Because okay. With the new linear systems, you can do everything, even for the staging of luminal tumors. It's easier because for me, you can direct the probe in the difficult positions. And with all of the systems that we have available for radial, the probe is before the endoscopic image. And whenever you have any problem, for instance, when you are staging a gastric cancer, you can stage exactly the same with a radial and with a linear. And there's a lot of studies stating that this is the way. But if there is, by any chance, you see a lymph node that can change the staging, you can access by an FNA and you don't need to switch scope. And there is another very important message, Thomas, for me in staging. Probably the problem was the quality of the image. We started with mechanical systems. You remember the mechanical was not as good as what we have today with the electronic systems. And probably we stopped a little bit on staging because the quality of B-mode and advanced imaging was not so good. With the new possibilities of the imaging today, I think we need to take over again this indication because the quality is much better. And probably with Elasto, probably with DFI or with contrast enhancement, we can even increase the capabilities to do it.
Okay, that was a clear message for the audience and a clear answer. So you think radial should go into the museum where the Hand of God and Mike Sivak are. I still must admit I like it for difficult cases, pancreas. I sometimes switch to the radial if I'm lost with the linear, but that's the luxury of having it. Good.
Yeah.
I think we'll touch a lot of points later. Maybe a final question. I'm also happy after many years where we have been struggling with cytology and very subjective interpretation. I think we now agree that histology and FNB or needles providing histology should be the standard, right?
Yeah, I think crown needles that allow us to do histology is also making a big change. I mean, today the field of oncology is moving to personalized medicine. And for personalized medicine, we need cores, not cytology. So probably there's also a change with advanced imaging plus FMB, because we are going to make a change in the management of tumors. Just an example, Thomas, lung cancer. It is not just if it's adenocarcinoma, epididymoid tumor. Now we need to know the mutations to know the immunotherapy, specific immunotherapy. And now we have the opportunity with the new needles to provide that information. So we are making a change. And in the pancreas, we've been in the same place for years because we have never been able to obtain a core. With core and new immunostaining and new molecular markers, probably we are going to make a change in the oncological treatment of pancreatic cancer. This is what I expect, and this is my hope, because we need to keep working. And I think we are in the beginning with the crown needles that it started yesterday. And I think we are going to make a change in the management of our patients. I'm sure.
Great, great. Good answers, perfect answers. I like clear messages, even if I may disagree sometimes with the radial. But anyway, so clear message. Do you want to just explain briefly the poll system before we go to the first live case? Or you do that later?
I think we have a message here that probably we were not expected to start from Santiago, but probably we need to start from Santiago. Mm-hmm. So the idea of the polls is to bring three questions to the audience that we want to discuss the answer at the end of the session. We want to know the information before the live cases and what we and so we can analyze the response after the live cases. So if we can have the questions, we can go together, Thomas, asking and yeah, give so the time for the people.
We show the questions now, maybe then also later, but that's not the, that's some questions from the audience, right? That's not for the polls. No polls from Slido, okay, good.
Okay, so Thomas, can you keep
so
for
maybe,
a moment?
Maybe you can tell us the questions we want to discuss later that the audience can prepare. Now we'll check in the meantime.
Okay, here we have.
Here we are.
Yes. Well, we start to have the question is in clinical practice, if we perform only diagnostic EUS, interventional EUS, or both. This is one of the questions we want to raise to the audience. And I think the people is starting to answer because we have the moving percentages, but I think
Diagnostic includes FNA, right?
FNA, yeah.
Yes.
So this is the first question. Mm-hmm. Do you perform in your center only diagnostic EUS? That includes FNA, of course, FMB. You just do interventional EUS, or in your centers you do both? That's the first question that we would love to have the answer from the the audience.
Well, honestly, I wouldn't advise to do just interventional EUS without any imaging, right?
Yes, but there's still some people that believe more, you know, Thomas, in MRI, MRCP, CT scan. Mm-hmm. They do ERCP, and they just realize that EUS is only useful for therapeutics because they absolutely rely on the results of CT scan and MRI, just as an
That's
example.
That's right, but at least they should be able to differentiate the bile duct from the portal vein.
Absolutely.
No?
Yes, because if not, they can put a stent in the portal vein, and that is not the best thing to do.
Yeah.
I don't know if we have the option to go for the second question of the poll.
Mm-hmm. So first question was, what do you do in EOS? How you specialize? And the second, can we have the second question? That was the first one, right?
Yes, so let's go for
there
the second one.
There must be another one.
Yeah, I think we have three questions for the poll. Okay, so next question is, in the case of interventional AUS, are you able to perform ERCP in the same session performed by the same operator? That means, are you believers on the AUS ERCP concept or not?
That's a very important question, Julio, yes? Because, you know, if you use EUS, like for in determinate cases, bile duct stones to select for ERCP, I think you should be capable to do two. Otherwise, you need two people.
Yeah.
But anyway, we'll see.
Yeah, that's one. That's the other question. And if we can go for the third question in the poll, that with the last one. Okay, and the last question in the poll. If it's AUS routinely used in your ERCP practice? I think the question, to make it easier to understand, yes, no, if you believe that AUS is essential to be done before an ERCP.
Yes, okay, good. So we'll wait for the replies later on. And,
yes,
and Julio, are you ready to do the first case? Do you have to run to the endoscopy suite?
I'm going mm-hmm. to switch my, because I am in close to my off, close to the room. So I'm going to go to the room because I think that we will try to start as soon as possible. So I will need you to moderate a little bit, Thomas, for 1 minute before we are able to connect in Santiago, so it will be nice if you can just have your a brief comment on the polls on what are your thoughts before the people start to ask. So
I'm going to stop
my video.
Right.
And I'm going to switch to the room.
Perfect. Thank you. So, ladies and gentlemen, that was a very good introduction. EOS has a broad horizon. And the questions asked are very important. So, first of all, you still need your training in diagnostic EUS in order to, you know, see lesions, identify lesions, and also within the lesion, identify the areas which might be the most suitable ones for biopsy. The second message is that we now do biopsy, we do histology, like with endoscopic biopsy. I was never very happy with cytology, because cytology may very often provide a diagnosis, but the procedures among cytologists are not so standardized. There are fewer cytologists than histopathologists, and the interpretation is much more objective. There's no second opinion process, et cetera, et cetera. So I'm happy to see that finally FNB or EOS-guided histology made the race, and is the way to go. I think Julio mentioned that he will show us a liver case. The liver hasn't been in the focus of US for a long time. I mean, in the staging of esophageal cancer, gastric cancer, we had a look at the left liver lobe, and there were early reports that some lesions missed by CT, MRI were picked up by US. In fact, these other modalities have improved quite a bit. They're widely available, and the standard of liver metastasis is maybe a good MRI. But there are people, you know, doing liver biopsy compared to, especially in the US, compared to a percutaneous biopsy. And there was a recent randomized trial from Orlando saying that percutaneous is better, but there was a very vivid discussion afterwards. There are other studies, and if Julio is ready, then for his life case, here we are. Julio, hi. That was Hello. A quick one. I'm very proud of you and your team. Welcome.
We just ran a little bit and we are ready. So now, welcome to Santiago.
What's your case?
Okay, first I would like to welcome all of you to Santiago, to the EUS room. And here I have here Danny, who is going to be the co-worker with me. Patricia, my nurse, we have Dr. Peiteado, who is the anesthesiologist, and Dr. Dominguez, which is the fellow, who is going to present the first case. So because we need the time, I think I'm going to give the word to Dr. Dominguez, that is going to present us what is the case that Danny and myself will be doing today. I can tell you that Danny will explain the system, but it's with the 740 UTA attached to the Arieta 850. So Dr. Dominguez, please, I give you the floor. So we have the slides, please.
Okay. Hello, everybody. We need the screen. We have here for the first case a 74 years old male with a habit toxic. He has an intake actually over than eight grams per day, and he is a former smoker. He has hypertension, hyperlipidemia, and he has admitted to our hospitalization unit because of an abdominal pain during 5 days and anorexia. During the admission, he had a good evolution. But the most important here is the result in the first blood test. That was an elevation of the lipase and a mild cholestasis with a normal bilirubin. So the first imaging technique we did is a percutaneous ultrasound. Now we can see in the next picture. Next one. We can see here two pictures about the percutaneous ultrasound, and we can see a dilatation of the main pancreatic duct and a and heterogeneous pancreatic with a chronic pancreatitis. So now we are going to perform an EUS B-mode evaluation with an elastography, a chef work, and then we are going to do a contrast and DFI. Thank you.
Thank you very much. You're now going to the case. So the question here is not whether it's a biliary pancreatitis. I think this seems to be pretty clear from the history and also from the transabdominal ultrasound. In the transabdominal ultrasound, there was just big stones and nothing else to see. So we are hoping for more details on US.
Yes, that's I'm here with Danny, which is one of the co-workers in the AUS and pancreatic unit. And just before Danny starts to show us part of the case, I think we have a case with an acute pancreatitis with two potential causes, which is the biliary stones that we saw in the transabdominal ultrasound, but it's a former smoker and a heavy drinker with more than 80 grams of alcohol per day. So what we arise in our mind is this might be an episode and a first attack on the context of a chronic pancreatitis. And that's why we believe AUS in this context is a key tool, because it provides great imaging of the parenchyma and of the duct. And I think, Danny, you're going to introduce and you're going to show us what we can see. So if we can have now the AUS image, please.
And Julio, it's linear because the radial is in the museum.
Yes, we are using the 740 UTA, which is the new system from Fuji, attached to the 850. And we can tell you that we are using all of the advanced imaging on. We have the harmonics, we have the compound, we have the e-focusing. And Danny, go ahead with the explanation and show us the nice image that we can obtain from the pancreas.
Perfect. We are now at the body of the stomach, and you can see here the pancreas body, and completely related to the percutaneous abdominal ultrasound found, we can see a dilated pancreatic duct in some changes related to chronic pancreatitis, like globularity. As you can see in the image of the body of the pancreas, and how this change remains until the tail of the pancreas.
But honestly, guys, this is not so advanced. Huh? There's still enough parenchyma. There are signs of a little bit signs of inflammation, but it's at least from those images, it's not far advanced. Would you agree?
This is one of the key points of this is one of the key things of EUS, Thomas. I think we as pancreatologists, and Danny and myself are endosonographers, but also pancreatologists. One of the goals of EUS is try to detect chronic pancreatitis as early as possible, with the aim to try to stop the natural evolution of these patients. So I think it's key. I mean, we're not using EUS to detect a calcific chronic pancreatitis. The idea is to use EUS to detect mild to moderate changes of chronic pancreatitis that absolutely is going to make us work with the patient. So that's what we want to show. How good is EUS to see what Danny is showing us in the image?
Yeah, we are now at the head of the pancreas. We are checking the biliary tract, and the changes related to chronic pancreatitis persist at the head of the pancreas. And we have here an interesting change. Look, I'm going to show you with the arrow. We have here the pancreatic duct that is dilated, arriving to the ampulla. Above is the biliary tree. But I want to show you another change. Look at the top of the image. Here. This patient probably has the pancreas division. Yeah. Look, the ventral pancreas is draining in the minor ampulla, and the dorsal pancreas is draining in the minor ampulla, and the ventral pancreas is draining in the major ampulla. And probably this patient may have a third cause for his acute pancreatitis. We have a toxic etiology, biliary etiology. Look, at the gallbladder, we have a lot of stones inside the gallbladder.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. But also, we have a slightly dilatation of the Santorini.
So just want to show all of the audience how AUS can guide us in the management of these patients with pancreatic diseases. What do you think, Thomas, on the imaging and
well, I think it's interesting. So it's not an attack of a very advanced chronic pancreatitis. So the biliary stones may come into play. So do you think we are misled by the alcohol? So and you might have divisum. So we have a variety of reasons for the pancreatitis.
Absolutely. So this is the best moment to be just an endosonographer. You do the report. Say chronic pancreatitis compatible with pancreas division. You say stones and give it to the pancreatologist to make the decision. So our job will be very easy just based on AUS. The problem is to manage these patients with all of the information we can get today with this high quality imaging.
Absolutely. But you seem to have a dilated pancreatic duct. Is that correct? Like here in the middle of the picture?
Danny, dilated duct?
Yes, it has a dilated duct. Yes. In the arrow, look.
Yeah, yes.
The main pancreatic duct at the head of the pancreas, the size is 5 millimeters.
When you do this, just for the beginners, do you do the Doppler to be sure that's not a vessel, or are you 100%? I mean, the chorus tells us when do you use Doppler to differentiate ducts from vessels?
I think it's a very good question. We use it quite often because we have a lot of trainees. And in the beginning, when you start doing AUS, it is very important to be sure what you look into. So I think we use a lot Doppler in the beginning of the learning curve. But when you start to have the knowledge on the anatomy, you start to use it lower and lower because you already know that that's a vessel or not. I think the role of Doppler, because we are a liver transplantation center and we are start to do a lot of liver cases, sometimes we use it for the evaluation of portal hypertension to see if there is a irregular flow We are just thinking on some ideas on analyzing the flow and the velocity. But for the routine to be able to distinguish between vessel, non-vessel, with the knowledge of the expertise, I think we just scanly you the Doppler. It is true
but
that
I think
we always use it whenever we're going to make a biopsy.
What's decisive here, I think, is the cores. So if you have one section, it could perhaps, question mark, be a vessel. But if you really show as nicely as Danny has done that the duct runs in the middle of the pancreas, you know, then you can be 99.9% sure.
Yeah, it's a question of anatomy.
Okay, yes. We start to have a lot of questions from the audience. I'm just have the poll here that I'm with the mobile. This is like in the live mm-hmm. when you are in a TV show. So they are talking about PET scan as compared to AUS in lymph node classification. Wow, very difficult question to answer. I think what is one different is that with AUS, we can be sure on the lymph node because we can make a biopsy. And we have PET scan, we do lung cancer staging, and there is a lot of false positive of the PET CT. So the role of AUS is to make a biopsy of the node to exclude malignancy. There is another comment on tissue is the issue, will disappear with the new technologies and cost, contrast and elastography? No, because I don't know any oncologist that it will treat a patient without a cell. So yeah. I think advanced imaging helps mostly to not biopsy benign diseases, but lead you to make a biopsy in high probability of malignant diseases because the oncologist is always going to need a histological diagnosis. Do you agree, Thomas?
Plus, as you said before, we have an increasing number of markers and we will have to have sub-differentiate the tumors into different classes according to which therapy should be selected. So I think tissue will become, as you pointed out before, tissue will become even more important. But yeah. can I point you back to the case? You have a dilated duct.
Sure.
Can you maybe show it to us where it runs into the duodenum and where the obstacle is? Where do we have a stone or is it a stricture? Or what's the problem of this patient with a pancreatic duct?
Okay, can we have the endoscopy image now in big for a moment? Para tener la endoscopy image so you can show the...
We have seen it as a small... Yeah, here okay. We are, so in the bulb.
Yes, now we are accessing D2. We can tell you what this with this scope is very easy because although it's a therapeutic scope, it's quite flexible. I will show you them because Danny will give me the opportunity to show you one thing with the scope. But look how we can see the ampulla by endoscopy because the image of this scope is it is almost frontal. It is not oblique, it's 30 degrees. So it brings some nice possibilities for the endoscopic evaluation and the quality of the endoscopy as all of the Fuji systems is really very high. So I think that's the ampulla. Okay, well, Danny is going to allow me a little bit. So
it's a little bit thickened, huh? So the distal CBD or whatever makes some bulging.
Yeah, so now we can switch again to ultrasound.
So where do you start your periampullary work? Directly at the papilla? You identify the papilla?
I always go under AUS. So what I usually do is whenever I reach into the bulb, I tip down, move a little bit inside, tip up, and place the probe in the duodenal knee. So then I just do a small movement to bring the portal vein here. So mm-hmm. to make it easier, we can put the Doppler. So we can very nicely see with the Doppler the portal vein with the confluence. When I'm in this position, what I'm going to do is do clockwise rotation, trying to follow and find the CBD that is a little bit enlarged here. So when I follow the CBD, I try to point it here. I follow the CBD very nicely in this case with this scope. And now, under AUS guidance, I reach D2 and the ampulla. So in my technique, what we are doing and what I love to do in my cases is go to the ampulla, not in endoscopy, but under AUS guidance, because I know that it's much safer to go to the tour to and to the ampulla and to the ampullary area. So
but the Julio, what's very important, the message for the people is that you start picking up the CBD from the upper duodenal curve, right? And yeah, then you follow it down to the ampulla. Once you have
it's a little bit different to what is written, but I found it much easier and less risky. Because if you have the duodenal collapse, the risk of perforating the duodenum when you try to access to the two is lower. Okay, so now that we've seen there is just a dilation, there is no lesion in the ampulla, because we didn't find neither Danny neither myself
mass at the ampulla.
I think there is no mass. Another thing to try to exclude any other thing is just to try to use our advanced imaging techniques. So we can use elastography in this case, and you can very nicely see that everything is green. So there is no blue spots in the ampulla. So this is very useful to exclude malignancy. Okay, and then if we want to really evaluate again the parenchyma, we can arrive to the parenchyma to see the degree of fibrosis. We can use again elasto. This is the strain elasto. And this is the typical pattern that we usually see in chronic pancreatitis. There is like a small blue background, but with a predominant green in the top. So this is the typical pattern that we see when we face chronic pancreatitis. Okay, so let's unfreeze. We see, as Danny showed us, the stranding, the foci. We can very nicely see one of the foci here, for instance, that need to measure more than 2 millimeters, and this foci is 3 millimeters. Okay. I really highlight the quality of the image that we are obtaining. And then if we come back, I will just like to show you in endoscopy. Please, can we have the endoscopy image?
I want to show you. You see it as a small image.
We are going to have it in big image, the endoscopy, because I want to show you one of the advantages of this scope is this is the 4.0 working channel. And just working a little bit with the scope, we can really do. Okay, a retroflexion. So we can really evaluate the complete stomach with the therapeutic scope, which is really a step up forward in the management and in the use of a therapeutic scope with all of the advantages that we can have to do a complete gastric evaluation. So we're coming back and just coming to the end, because I think I'm sure in Rome, they might be ready to start.
They might be ready. Yes, we may have, Julio, we have three to five minutes. Can I insist on one question? What's the reason of the ductal dilatation? Is it a stricture? Or is it at the level of the papilla? We didn't see a stone, did we?
Probably it's a chain related to chronic pancreatitis. The fibrosis on the parenchyma is causing the dilated of the main pancreatic duct.
But is this a case for therapeutic ERCP with maybe ductal stenting or a sphincterotomy? Or
I can tell you honestly, with these findings, no stricture, no stones. If the patient evolves well and there is no pain, we will not stent.
So the ductal diameter, you think it's within the limits, or is it too much?
No, I think it's dilated, but I don't find any stenosis or anything to treat in this moment. The patient now is admitted for 5 days. Now is no pain, good evolution. So we will put the patient under a strict follow-up, but will not indicate an ERCP in this moment with the situation, although we have a slight dilation of the PD of 5 to 6 millimeters.
And no MRCP either?
I'm going to give you a question. Do you think MRI is going to provide more information than what we have obtained by EUS?
I think it's a little bit better for fine abnormalities of the duct to have the overall picture, but it can be debated.
Yeah, what is important, if you take a look at the PD here in the image, when we are reaching the distal part of the body and tail, the dilation, it's not a complete dilation. It seems like this is a little bit of acute phase with a small dilation because of the acute phase of the relapse of the disease But the PD here, it is, it's about 3 millimeters to 0.28 millimeters. So probably I still believe that there is dilation between the head and the neck of the pancreas, a little bit in the body. But when we are reaching the distal part, this dilation is going, is disappearing. So it is probably not so problematic in the, if the patient is asymptomatic.
So let's call it borderline duct in the head, which then gets smaller in the body. And signs of early chronic pancreatitis. So that's the conclusion from that case, right?
Yes, I just want to show you the that it's very nice to see live the DFI. So it's how we can analyze the microvascularization of this. This is the liver. Let's move to the pancreas. This is brand new technique. So this is just to show you what we can see. And look, this is the pancreatic parenchyma. And in real time, with detective flow imaging, we can evaluate the microvascularization inside of the this inflamed or this chronic pancreatitis. We are in the under evaluation of this technique. We want to find if there's any change between chronic pancreatitis and normal pancreas, and also in the different degree of chronic pancreatitis. But this is an ongoing study with this brand new technology that provides really amazing images, as you can see.
Okay, so I see that. So that's
you can see the small vessels within the pancreas. So we are evaluating the microvascularization inside of the pancreas.
So that's a whole new field for studies to look at the small vessels. I'm sure that Japanese people will like it because they like small vessels.
Just before finishing, I want to give the scope back to Danny, and I want Danny to show you one of the options of this scope, which is doing shear wave elastography. And I want you, Danny, to show us either in the pancreas or even in the liver. And I think with the shear wave, we can just, if Rome is ready, we can move to the first case of Rome.
Yeah, Rome is waiting. So let's have
a couple of evaluations.
Perfect. Finally. New approach for evaluation of the liver is the shear wave. Usually we perform shear wave by percutaneous equipment, but nowadays with these new scopes, we can perform shear wave in the liver during the evaluation of the pancreas and other structures. And we can obtain measures of the fibrosis of the parenchyma during the US evaluation of the pancreas, liver, or other structures. And this is another promising tool of this equipment.
Okay,
so
I think we see.
Just cover all... Yes, Thomas?
Right, so that's what people now call endohepatology. That's also partially based on the EUS. Okay, great guys. This was a wonderful performance, and I think we come back later. So let's go to Rome, where Francesco and Serena are with another case. Please, can we connect to Rome? With Rome.
Hello to everyone.
Hello. Hello. Hi.
Thank you so much for the kind invitation for these outstanding events. Thank you, Professor Roche. Thank you, Professor Repici. Thank you, Yuli Iglesias. I'm so proud to be here with Serena Stigliano, who is performing a radial EUS with a new probe, and Raimondo, the nurse, and Alessandro, the anesthesiologist, and all the staff, technical staff. So we can start with the description of the case. Please, could you send? Yes, this case was sent to us from another hospital to check if it's possible to submit this patient to a full thickness resection. This is a 70 years old female with hypertension, diabetes, type 2, GERD symptoms. At a gastroscopy on December 2022, there was a presence of a polypoid lesion of 20 millimeters in the gastric antrum with normal overlying mucosa. So as usual, we perform always US procedure before a full thickness resection, exposed or not exposed. That's why we are using this tool. And the radial one, this new probe with the new Arietta, is a particularly useful for these purposes. That's line to you, please.
Thank you. So good afternoon. As you said, we are using the scope EG580UR. It is the radial scope with, of course, the forward view. And we usually use this scope for this for the study of this subepithelial lesion, even because it's easy, especially for the smaller one, to see them in the, especially in the stomach and in the esophagus. And also because as you can see here from the picture, how the view is nice with this scope. Well, the radial scope, it's also handleable like the standard gastroscope. It's easy to move, and also it can retroflex easily and give us the chance to see all the, even the fundus of the gastric fundus.
So I'm happy to see a radial scope because Giulio just told us it belongs to the museum in Spain, but I'm happy that to see it live and well in Italy. And I must admit, I also like radial EOS, but so please convince us.
Yeah, well, I think for this kind of lesion, it's important and easy. It's easy to understand all the layer of the stomach of the esophagus. So now switching on you see here the endoscopic image of this subepithelial lesion. It is almost, I think, 20, 25 millimeters in the antrum of the stomach. And now I try to deflate the stomach to reduce the artifact of air from the air in the stomach. We usually fill the stomach with water. I don't like to use the balloon, especially with the small lesion. I think maybe if we use it, it's possible to make some artifacts or try to push too much to the lesion. So you can see here with the Arietta system how the wall layer are easy to see. You see the inner one, hyperechoic mucosal layer, the hypoechoic one, that is the muscularis mucosa, and the other hyperechoic one, that is the submucosa, and the thicker hypoechoic layer, that is the muscular propria. So here,
Serena.
Yeah.
Generally, when you see your lesion on that scope, in order to, because the transducer is behind the optic, so you have to traverse the lesion and then switch on EOS, right?
Yeah. Yeah. We usually we see the lesion with the endoscopic view. Then I go through the lesion, and then I try to pull back the scope just to have a better view of the lesion. You can see here on the right of the screen, and it seems like hypoechoic lesion, and like to take it.
Almost looks like a cystic lesion, right?
Well, it is like, I would like to show you better because it has like a small pedunculus. No, it's the name, and it has a polyp aspect. Maybe it's not so fluid. I think it's more hypoechoic because it has the same echogenicity of the muscular layer. I think it could origin from the external muscular layer. I'm trying to better. It's not so big the lesion, so.
You know, when you see this endoscopically, you are tempted to take a snare and take it out. Would that be appropriate?
Well, I think it's always better to see from which layer it origin, because from here, I would say that you can see the mucosal layer is normal. And also the where is the pointer? Okay, thank you. Maybe this is the submucosal layer. So the real lesion actually it's this is a part of the real region. So maybe if I could use the snare, but maybe as a part of the lesion will stay in the stomach. So I think it's always better for this kind of lesion where the overlying mucosa is normal. It's always better to study with the endoscopic ultrasound. Here it's.
But is it pedunculated or not?
Yeah, it has a small one, I think. I think that the part that we are seeing is the head of the polyp, and also maybe it's like attraction from the muscular one. So it's like it origin from the external muscular layer, and then for the weight, just lying like attraction in the inside the gastric lumen. Okay. Of course, maybe in these I could try with more water.
But isn't it that you have the muscular layer around at the outer side of the stomach?
Well, here it's normal.
Yes, it's normal.
Here it's normal.
Yes.
But I have seen before, I would like to show you, there is a small part in communication with the here. It seems like we have a small connection here with the muscular, even because it is covered with the mucosal layer. Maybe we can enlarge it. The mucosal layer, the submucosal, it's normally represented here.
Would you like to check with a contrast medium or not?
Yeah, it could be. Well, in the stomach, I think if we say that, as it seems, it origin from the fourth layer in the stomach, it could be a gastrointestinal stromal tumor or a leiomyoma. So maybe it could be useful to use the contrast enhancement to see the different aspects of the lesion. I expect that if it's a GIST tumor, it could take contrast.
So interesting would be to speculate what's the differential diagnosis.
Okay. Yeah, I think the differential diagnosis in this case is between leiomyoma and GIST tumor.
And what about a cystic aberrant pancreas?
An heterotopy. Well, the position is not so common, and also, can I enlarge the picture? Maybe the endoscopic aspect is not so typical. If it was a heterotopic pancreas, I could imagine. I would expect an umbilicate.
You're right. But there are forms which are very rare forms which could be cystic. So you don't see the pancreas so much, you see a cyst. But we will know after you have resected it, right?
Yeah, non ce l'ho. Non mi piace. Well, I think, now we had used the contrast and, it doesn't seem to take it.
So it's echo free and it doesn't take any contrast.
No, it doesn't seem to take any contrast.
Is that typical for leiomyoma or GIST?
Yeah.
Wouldn't GIST take contrast?
Usually GIST take contrast. So if I should say how can I get back? I think it could be a leiomyoma. Of course, the final diagnosis we can have it only with after the endoscopic resection, and it is a small lesion. It's almost 20 millimeters. So we, well, the leiomyoma doesn't have a malignant behavior. So maybe we could suggest 1 year follow-up of the patient, or maybe just talk with the patient about the this chance. Of course, if we remove it and it seems possible with well,
so which resection technique would you choose for the full thickness? Is it too big? What do you think?
Well,
we rather prefer to use ESD procedure in this case.
Okay.
So it's not scheduled for a full thickness.
Yeah.
There's no indication for full thickness, as they asked to our group. We prefer ESD for the better control of bleeding during the procedure, and because it's more precise technique. That is
right. And nowadays, you know, if it goes deeper and you make a hole, there are several methods of closure.
Yeah, right.
So we don't have to be too concerned as we were 20 years ago or 10 years ago.
Yeah, right.
Totally okay.
Agree. Yeah.
So
and also,
we...
sorry. No, I just to say that another important aspect is to see if we have some lymph node near the stomach, but it seems clean.
Yeah.
No lymph node, and all the layer of the in the other part of the stomach are normally represented. So I think we discussed with the patient about follow-up or maybe a resection.
Right.
Yeah.
Well, thank you very much. Looking back honestly on the issue of submucosal tumors when I was a young doctor, something has changed, but the endosonographic image is still not so conclusive. The thing which really has changed is that our resection techniques have improved. So, you know, 20, 30 years ago, it was quite difficult. Huh? So we couldn't offer the patient the resection alternative, but nowadays we have it. So we have the choice of follow up, maybe repeatedly long term, or take it out and then we know what it is. And patients decide differently, huh? Okay.
Yeah.
Good.
Thank you.
So thanks very much for that beautiful presentation.
Thank you.
And we go on. And the next speaker is Andrea Andaloni, previously in Milano, now in Pavia. When we welcomed you before the meeting, you were connected within a train, which I like very much, Andrea. Now you are in a stable internet position for your lecture. And if I stand correctly, and a very warm welcome, you will speak about the transition into therapeutic EUS, especially in the hepatopancreaticobiliary area.
You are definitely right, Thomas, as usual, on many points. Yes, I was on train, and surprisingly, the Italian train was on time. So I'm now here in my office, in my house, where the connection should be stable, and I hope also the room, because I have the three daughters just behind the door that could be do something unexpected. But leaving the jokes, I really enjoyed the first part of this meeting. I really enjoyed the discussion that you have done, and I really enjoyed the new images that the outstanding doctors were performing. Let me tell you something, but now I would like to take you higher to another level of possibilities. I want you to go out from the EUS room and to move to what we call an hybrid biliopancreatic endoscopy room. So if it's okay for you, I would like to share my presentation. I just need you to tell me that you are correctly seeing everything.
Yes, perfect.
Okay. So As we may know, EUS and ERCP have been gone in two separate way until a few years ago. Each one had a very interesting application, and each one tried year by year to enhance their potential, either from the diagnostic point of view and from the therapeutic point of view. But till few years ago, the two procedures were just considered and separate, different, sometimes also like enemies. But the clinic condition, the clinic situation, the clinic scenario that we are facing day by day is telling us something else. It's telling us that we may need a new philosophy, a new approach. And this is mainly due to specific topics, like the failed biliary cannulation in neoplastic diseases that could happen either in a normal papilla, but I would like to remember that this should be only in less than 5% of the cases. Otherwise, the problem could be not only the papilla, but maybe also your hands, or in case of duodenal stenosis that won't allow us to reach the papilla for a retrograde approach. But nowadays we have to face again with altered anatomy. We thought in the past that altered anatomy was going into the museum with the radial, but surprisingly, nowadays we are facing with more and more altered anatomy, thanks also to the developing of bariatric surgery. So in such a case, we realized that maybe the two sister, EUS and ERCP, could be connected one to each other in both of the direction. We can go from ERCP to EUS and vice versa, depending on specific situation. And this is pretty much interesting because this new approach could help us being more appropriate, more giving more efficacy to our effort in treating our patients in the endoscopy room. In the past, definitely, when an ERCP was failing, we were going to the radiologist or to the surgeon to ask for their help. But nowadays, for many, many situations, we may find some solution in our home. And this is something that started almost 10 years ago with the interventional EUS. That means the possibility to go and to reach the biliary duct or other areas by transmural approach. So nowadays, as far as the biliopancreatic disease is concerned, we can go either retrograde versus antegrade or transpapillary versus transmural. Many, many options in the same room, hopefully with the same hands. And this is called, let's say, HPB evolution, that is related to the evolution of instruments, evolution of devices, and evolution of indication. I really like to stress this concept because sometimes we have new indication because we can do new things with new devices and we can do it with new instruments. But on the other hand, we can have new devices and new instruments because of the need of new indication. So these three areas are strictly connected between each other in what we call the HPB revolution. So we started borrowing some devices from the ERCP in order to be able to reach the bile duct, to reach the gallbladder, to reach the fluid collection, to do interventional. Later on, we were able to develop specifically designed devices for EUS interventional. And this was the starting of the new era. The arriving of the lumen opposing metal stent allow us to do all the thing in an easier way, but also to open our mind to new approaches. I think, Thomas, that we are facing a milestone in the endoscopy history, like the one that you were saying with the fine needle aspiration from Peter Wielman, or the first cannulation in the 1970s. So this is quite important because it's something that make me enthusiastic, because we are the witness of this big changing. The big change, it can allow us to do and to perform procedure on the bile duct, like rendezvous procedure, choledochoduodenostomy, to drain the gallbladder as a rescue approach, or to do the hepatogastrostomy. That means that nowadays we are able to perform internally what we were doing radiologically externally. The rendezvous procedure was described in the past, and is, let's say, a sort of approach that allow us to do sequential approach between EUS and ERCP. It's very demanding, very long, it's quite difficult, and you need to have the reachable papilla in order to conclude your procedure. Here's something that is going to the museum with radial and with other stuff. Probably, although I think we still have space for treating benign condition. Of course, the new approach with lamps allow us to perform quickly, easily, safely, and with a great efficacy, the choledochoduodenostomy. And this opened a new era in treating, especially the patient with pancreatic cancer. We had the opportunity also to realize that also the gallbladder could be a nice target, not only to be drained in course of acute cholecystitis in fragile patients, but also as a rescue drainage to drain patient with stricture, neoplastic stricture. Last but not least, we are now able to perform hepaticogastrostomy. That means we are able to do intrahepatic drainage inside the stomach, the same that the percutaneous drainage perform, but with everything inside. I think this is something incredible, but we have to bear in mind that this last approach is one of the most demanding in the biliopancreatic endoscopy. And this is mainly due to the fact that it's technically demanding and the possibility of having very heavy adverse events. Until now, we had usual linear scope, but nowadays we have a new concept of linear scope that is specifically designed for intervention. I think this is a new concept because with the help of moving the lens upper in comparison with the operative channel, we were able to have a new specific evaluation that helped us being sharp and precise, not only during EUS, but also during the endoscopic evaluation. This is pretty much a nice picture that can help us understanding that the EUS scope, the therapeutic scope, is moving towards also the duodenoscope, not only with the lens, but also with the operative channel that nowadays is reaching 4 millimeters and is quite nice and easy for performing intervention. Of course, new indication, because we have new instrument. In case of duodenal stricture, we can perform endoscopic ultrasound-guided gastrojejunostomy. And at the beginning, this approach was performed to overcome stricture, so outlet gastric obstruction. But nowadays, we may use this approach also for other reasons. That means to open a new door on a new level of therapeutic. In case of bariatric surgery, in case of altered anatomy, we are able to perform a gastrogastrostomy to allow the duodenoscope to pass through and to reach the papilla. That means that we are able to pass from the altered anatomy to come back to the usual anatomy. I think this is a great achievement because allow us also to have the access in the 7 days after the ERCP in order to treat possible complication. But before giving you the line again, I want to stress a very important last question. When we speak about biliopancreatic endoscopy, we are not speaking only about EUS on the ERCP. Remember that, especially in altered anatomy, we can have other possibilities like the enteroscopy with a double balloon. And nowadays, Fuji have also developed a smart, short double balloon enteroscope that allow us to perform also retrograde approach. At the end, I would say that Fujifilm is giving us right now what I call the biliopancreatic tower, where I have everything inside so that I can just choose the best solution for that patient in that condition, in that specific moment. And I think this is quite important to us as an operator, because having a partner that won't force me to use one or the other, but give me the opportunity to choose, will make my life easier. At the end, let's say that nowadays in biliary disease, we are not speaking anymore about single instrument, about EUS on the RCP. We are speaking about diseases. We are speaking about condition. We are speaking about patient. Basically, we are speaking about biliopancreatic endoscopy. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Andrea. You raised a lot of points. We'll have a discussion at the end of this session after the live cases. And there are a lot of questions coming out. You know, for example, is somebody who is fit in all three techniques you have mentioned, is he still able to do ESD, or does he spend the entire day with the pancreatobiliary stuff? Big question mark for the future, has to be decided. But as I said, we'll come to all these questions after the live cases. And thank you very much for your beautiful lecture with the nice images, as with a very high quality we are used from you. And of course, you were mentioning and thanking our sponsor, Fujifilm, for providing the entire spectrum. We have seen the images. Fuji also has an X-ray machine. So they're really keen on providing you the full spectrum. And in order to get a little bit more visibility, we go to the next live cases. Again, in Santiago, Julio, there was a question that the instruments should be presented as such a little bit more. You said that they are written. Can you elaborate on this a little bit?
Okay. Hello. Hello, good Hi. Afternoon. Hi. We're going to present the case first.
Okay. Yes, we need another, sorry, for the technique. We need the big picture with the life.
Yes, we have the pictures of the case.
Yes. Yeah. But we want you to have for the transmission people. Oh, here we are. Okay.
Okay, for the last case, we have a 45-year-old female without toxic habits with an IgE-mediated rhinitis and with psoriasis. This patient has an unusual treatment at home. She has been referred to the pathology unit because of an abdominal discomfort and an elevation of cholestasis with a normal bilirubin. She has a normal GABA globulins and positive asthma and ANAS. The rest of the study was normal and negative. Next one, please. We did an percutaneous ultrasound that was normal, and we did also a fever scan which doesn't show a fibrosis. So now we are going to perform an EUS remote evaluation and an EUS guided liver biopsy.
Okay, thank you. Here we are with endohepatology. Jose, show us the liver, which we haven't maybe paid enough attention to in the past.
Okay, hello. Thank you very much. First of all, say hello to all the people, all the audience that is attending us. And of course, I do really appreciate the invitation to participate in this important live session, in which we are going to the topic of today. We are going to discuss about the role of the EUS liver biopsy. As you know, we know that endoscopic ultrasound is a very good technique for the evaluation of all the liver lesions. We know that it's important in the differential diagnosis of focal liver lesions. But in this point, we're going to discuss about the possibility of diagnosis of liver parenchymal diseases by performing a liver biopsy in the same way as the percutaneous route or the trajugular route, for example. So in this sense, the potential benefits that we have when we are using EUS in obtaining liver specimens is that we can sample both lobes of the liver. So we have a transduodenal approach to target the right hepatic lobe of the liver, but we have also the transgastric approach in order to target the left hepatic lobe of the liver. So this is a very important benefit of this technique. Of course, the comfort of the patient, so the anxiety of the patient is completely decreased because we have a very good anesthesiologist here with us that is doing the deep sedation of the patient. So we have a lot of comfort for the procedure. And another important benefit is that the recovery time of the patient is just 1 hour. So if we compare with the recovery time of the percutaneous liver biopsy, that is about 4 to 6 hours, is completely different to discharge the patient only in a period of 1 hour. But perhaps the most important advantage that we have when we are doing EUS is the possibility of assessing the pancreatobiliary system. So it means that we are performing an EUS, as you can see here, for evaluating pancreatic or for rule out pancreatic diseases. So you can see here in the picture a normal pancreatic parenchyma with the ampulla, with the CBD, the pancreatic duct in the picture. So it's possible to do it at the same time as the liver biopsy. In fact, we can also rule out, if we see the CBD, any kind of other etiological factor involved in a cholestasis, for example, a cholelocholithiasis. And it's also possible, apart from looking at the gallbladder, it's also possible to rule out, for example, the presence of signs of portal hypertension, ruling out the presence of esophageal varices. So for this, all of these are important advantages of the US liver biopsy. Okay, so now we are going to do the first pass from the transduodenal approach. And there's an important concept that we have to take into account here. That is the concept of the sample adequacy. This is a concept that is established by several associations, for example, that establish several specific requirements to consider a sample as an adequate. For example, we have an American Association for the Study of the Liver Disease that consider that any sample, any specimen that doesn't fit these requirements are not considered as good specimens. For example, the number of complete portal tracts more than 11, or the total specimen length more than 2 centimeters. What I mean is that all the samples that we are obtaining with this route that are not achieving these specific requirements, we cannot consider as a good sample. And so we have to reconsider what we are doing in our clinical routine. Okay, so as you can see here, we have to select a good path for introducing the needle inside the liver parenchyma and some technical points that I would like. So.
One little question. Didn't this patient have a gallbladder stone? So you had a look at the CBD to rule out the CBD stones on the transabdominal ultrasound?
A CBD stone is by routine. So we are always performing an evaluation of all the CBD, but it was not the suspicion. The suspicion was not a cholelocholithiasis, but we are evaluating in all the cases the gallbladder and the CBD.
Okay, so that's part of the liver examination to...
It's a part of the common procedure.
Yes, okay. To have the gallbladder and the bladder covered.
Okay, so some important medical points that I would like to highlight is, first of all, the needle that we are going to use. Well, I have to say that we are using a Fuji equipment. There is a 580 with a working channel of 3.8 millimeters. And it's important, the needle that we are going to use. For in my personal experience, it has no sense to use any other needle that is not a 19 gauge needle. So we have to use the thickest needle that we have for doing a puncture. Another important point is that we should use histological needles, core needles, because the specimen that we are going to obtain is better for the core needles than the fine needle aspiration needles, because these kind of needles are not designed for doing a biopsy, and the core needles are designed for doing a real biopsy. And finally, how to prepare the needle. This is an also important point. We use the standardized technique and a standardized protocol, which includes the wet suction heparin technique. So it means that we are priming with heparin the working channel of the 19 gauge needle previous performing the liver biopsy in order to avoid the presence of clots, the presence of clogging. So we use the wet suction heparin technique, as you are going to see here. We have prepared the needle, and after doing the puncture, we are going to attach the syringe to the working channel. So we have selected this route, that is the transduodenal approach. In our protocol, in our center, we are always performing both passes, transduodenal and transgastric, because we should really believe that this is the best technique, and this is the way for obtaining better specimens in order to combine both approaches. So I would like to take the needle now. And as I told you before, this is a 19 gauge, in this case, Francine needle. It's a core needle. So we are introducing the needle inside the working channel of the 580 equipment of Fuji, the condoscope. So we are attaching the needle to the condoscope. And so now we are going to target in this case, the right lobe of the liver. So we can select this path, that is a good path. And so now we are going to try to see the needle, where is the needle, is in this position. And now with a quick shot, this is a quick shot, and we are inside the liver. So now we are going to open the syringe, and now we are going to do two and four movements, not more than three or four. With this should be enough in order to obtain the liver specimen, as I'm doing.
Jose?
Yes?
So you are having simple suction?
Yes, this is a wet suction, simple suction.
None of those...
wet suction, wet suction.
None of those wet sorry, did I get
wet
it right?
Suction, because in some experience, in some studies, it seems that the wet suction is better than the dry suction.
Mm-hmm.
Or
okay,
suction.
Good.
That is the idea.
Yeah.
So now important. We are going with the needle in order to expel the sample in a specific. And now the camera, please, here. We are going to expel the sample.
Can we have the camera picture big, please?
Yes, we have the camera here to see our tissue sheaves that we are used. That is an.
Can you change the picture, please? The big picture to the camera picture.
Picture, camera. Ah, okay. So now we are looking.
Thank you.
Okay. So now this is a tissue sheath, and with the stylet, we're introducing the stylet inside the working channel of the needle in order to try to get the sample in these tissue sheaths. The material that we are obtaining is always very blood. So now we have to flush gently with saline in order to try to see if we have obtained a sample or not. So we are flushing with saline, sorry. We have to avoid, and sometimes we get material, and other times it's a little bit more difficult to obtain. And now, for example, I have to say that this is not a very good sample, not at all. So we are going to repeat the procedure, because the sample that we are obtaining is scant in this case. I recognize that. So when we are dealing with this small sample, it's not considered a good sample. We have to repeat a pass. We can do it. Both passes from the duodenum and both two passes from
Jose,
the stomach. Yes?
I find this a very nice trick to get rid of blood, to have this net and flush and then push it on the cloth that the, you get rid of some of the blood there, right? You could do it with other punctures as well.
That's the reason for doing that. Yeah.
I've seen this for the first time. So I think that's a little detail which... should be communicated. Yes.
Of course. So now if you want, if you have any kind of commentary, any kind of question, when I'm going to repeat the biopsy.
You do the biopsy point. Again? I think we can maybe
yes,
move on.
The sample that we obtained was very yeah. bad, really, really bad. So we can do it from the stomach, or we can
so if it, sorry, from the if, it, if it's okay, we go on to the next case, and okay. we come back to
perfect.
You, and when you...
With the case.
When you have a nice specimen to have a look at the specimen, okay?
Perfect. It's all right.
Great.
Okay.
Thank you. Thank you very much for this very nice demonstration.
Thank you.
And we'll move on to Roma.
Okay.
Yes, tell us about the case.
Let's go with the other case. This is an 80-year-old female patient with a diagnosis of locally advanced pancreatic cancer in the head of the pancreas. She received in October 2022 an ERCP with the positioning of an uncovered metal stent. After a few months, vomit occurred, so she was also she underwent to an endoscopic ultrasound gastroenteroanastomosis. In January 2023, several episodes of cholangitis occurred that was resistant to antibiotic therapy. So she had MRI that showed slight dilation of the intrahepatic bile duct with a distension of the gallbladder that was full of sludge. So we tried to have another ERCP, but it failed because of the impossibility to get into the bile duct because of the obstruction of the distal part of the metal stent from the tumor. So the procedure scheduled for today is the EUS-guided hepaticogastrostomy. Thank you.
Okay.
Hello to everyone. Thank you again for the kind presentation. I'm lucky because I'm working with a new probe, EG740UT and a Arietta 815FF. As we heard by Andrea in the nice presentation, nice lecture before, these are instruments that are designed properly for therapeutic EUS. This probe, for example, has some feature that we love so much. For example, a bigger channel, 4 millimeter, a G-lock system of the elevator. It's very, very nice, and it's a tough, rigid enough for the therapeutic purposes. And this feature added with the feature of the new Arietta seems to be a really a good marriage. This is the case is an atopic case because we scheduled this patient, as you heard before, for the hepaticogastrostomy. But this is a case of double stenosis, the stenosis of duodenum, second part of duodenum, and stenosis of the biliary tree. So you heard that we perform already gastroenteroanastomosis, but in order to avoid the cholangitis, we scheduled this patient for hepaticogastrostomy. But looking for a site to place the right window to place a stent, we saw aerobilia and not so much dilation of the left part of the, as you can see now, yeah, not so much dilation of the left hepatic duct. And, sorry if I remind to the audience that the hepaticogastrostomy is performed in the upper part of the stomach, trying to get the access from the second and the third segment of the left liver lobe. You must avoid to puncture, of course, even if this, the pathway is straight, you must avoid to puncture the left lobe by the esophagus. through the vestibulum of the esophagus. So we use for the particle gastrostomy, of course, radiology. But in this case, there's no space to put a stent. So to avoid cholangitis, we try to see now if the gallbladder has some problem. This could be another option. I don't know if you agree. You can see now from the images from Marietta that there's ascites. And so I'm the bulb. I'm trying to see now if I got some other windows to get the access on the gallbladder.
So do you know the previous metal stent? Does it pass the cystic duct? Do we know?
Right question, of course. We know that there is an uncovered stent. The stenosis didn't reach the insertion of the cystic duct, but probably now with a metal stent, we are not sure that is the patency of the cystic duct is allowed till now. But we got just these images here, and we think that the last option that we can get is to put here a lamps. I don't know if you agree or not, but
so you wanna instead drain the gallbladder.
Yeah.
Can you explain us again why the original plan would probably not work?
Not work because, as I show you before, I got no a space, a windows to get access on the left liver lobe, and there's no huge dilation of the duct. And most of all, I see aerobilia in all the liver. Sorry, I have to check again for the picture.
Which means that there is still some connection through the stent, but insufficient.
Yeah.
And aerobilia makes the puncture more difficult, is that correct?
Yes. But for us, it means that the stent is still working.
Okay.
I didn't show you the duodenal stenosis. I can do now in few.
No, it's seconds. Fine. I just wanted to summarize for the audience. So
the left lobe, yeah. There's no.
Oh, there's quite a lot of air.
Yeah, that's why we think as the cause of this fever, we think that the gallbladder has a role.
The gallbladder is full, huh?
Yeah, that's why we are changing our plan. So.
Okay, here we are. So which stent are you going to use?
Yeah. We are using lamps, axios lamps, mm-hmm. of 10 × 10 millimeters. Why this size? Because all this debris inside, I'm scared about all this debris inside. And so I want to avoid the clogging of the stent. And I can get the access by the gastroscope of 9 millimeters if I have to wash something. So we try to always to put the guide wire inside, always, even if we don't use it so much. But as a rescue tool, we love to have something that can reach easily the target.
So, and the instrument position is where in the bulb at the moment?
The bulb.
In the bulb. Okay.
In the bulb. I'll show you the stenosis of them. I don't know if you can see the endoscopic image.
We see
we see this, the endoscopic image small right here. Here we see the tumor infiltration.
Yeah, right.
Okay, so please go ahead.
As you know, this is a single operator device, actually. It's a...
Can you please switch back to ultrasound?
Yeah. Potete rimettere l'equendo, per favore?
Here we are. There's also ascites, huh?
Yep. Right.
Is ascites a contraindication for a hepatogastrostomy?
Not an absolute contraindication in our experience. Of course, it depends from the amount of ascites.
Mm-hmm.
If it's a huge amount, most of all in the left lobe. I try to find the best position. And with this so sensitive colored Doppler, is quite useful to avoid the vessel. All this feature with this brand new echo processor are better with the old probe too. It means with a 580 probe seems to be work better. I try to put that on for the Buscopan, per favore. I try to use Buscopan 2 to avoid.
But what do you think? That's debris in the gallbladder?
Pardon?
You think this is debris in the gallbladder?
Yeah.
But why do we have Doppler echoes there sometimes?
It's just movements. It's so sensitive that.
Okay. So you have now your stent introduced, I guess?
Which stent I introduced? A 10-10.
10 axios, it's already in the channel?
Yeah, it's already in the channel. Mm-hmm.
Well, I guess sometimes as endoscopist, you would need three arms. So, you know, it also happens in other interventions, colonoscopy or so. Sometimes you need somebody to fix the scope that you can work with your two other arms. Enhance.
Mi dai per favore scopia, per favore? Okay.
So here is you see on the left side you see the tip of the axios right. Coming out.
That's a portal hypertension. So I try to avoid vessel as much as I can.
Well, sometimes it's better not to know too much.
Yeah. Here we are.
So now we seem to have a good position away from the stopless signal.
Now and you're fixing. Pardon?
You're burning your way into the gallbladder?
Yeah. I'm releasing the distal flange.
So you also have a feeling when you are in, right?
Not that so much. Not so much.
But it's now, like a resistance, which, yeah, here we see it.
Yeah. Now I'm moving. The third movement is withdrawing the lamps to the parietal wall. And then I perform the four movements inside the channel.
Okay, most people do it in the channel. There are also people who want to see it on the endoscope. So you have to move away, and but you prefer to release it in the channel and then go back.
If you can see on the endoscopy image, we are trying to release the...
It's almost open.
Yeah.
There's fluid coming out. Good sign.
Unfortunately, there's no methylene blue. I hope.
I think that might have been the reason, huh?
Yeah, probably.
Hey.
Will be no the content of colon. I hope so.
Yeah, it's like a badly prepped colon.
Yeah. But from the X-ray image, you can see that aerobilia makes a contrast in the biliary 3-2.
Mm-hmm.
That's why I don't know if you can see now on the on the monitor. Usually with this debris so dense, we prefer to leave a nose cystic.
For flushing, huh?
Yeah, for flushing, exactly.
For a day or so.
Could you give me something to put a nose?
Okay. I think we are a little bit getting short of time. So the procedure was very nicely performed. And one last question. Do you do dilatation?
No. Usually we don't use dilatation. We used to put always inside something to wash.
Okay. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Good.
No, cateter guida con guida. Li mettiamo un naso biliare.
And the most important thing is to tell the nurses on the ward or the personnel on the ward that they should actually flush the catheter and not leave it alone.
Right. Yeah, exactly. Yeah, exactly.
Okay, Francesco, that was a beautiful presentation. We
thank you.
See the inner stent end.
Yeah.
And I think we just go back to Santiago for a second. I want to show the liver in a cage. Oh, okay. Jose, can you hear us?
Can you hear me?
Yes.
¿Me conectáis? Yes. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Okay, this is the result of the second transduodenal pass that we did. So this is a good sample. So this is very important to point out that we should repeat the procedure if we are not training real cores. In this case, this is the material that we are obtaining from the transduodenally, but we also did another additional pass from the stomach. So we have performed three passes in this case. And these are the results of the technique. Okay.
Mm-hmm.
So
looks
you have
great.
Any kind of thank you.
As
I would like to say just one thing to end is that we are carrying out a study in which we are comparing in a randomized fashion these results about sample adequacy in liver specimens with this route, with the EUS, against the percutaneous route. And the idea and the results is that we are obtaining very, very similar or even better specimens by EUS than the percutaneous route. So we are ready to publish very good results according to this technique. And I believe that this technique is going to be present in the future in more centers and more clinical practice.
Great.
Thank you very much.
Thanks very much. As I said before, I go buy this little box tomorrow because I like your flushing technique as well. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you.
Okay, we now going to have a final discussion of 15, 20 minutes. And I see Andrea, maybe Julio is also there. Julio, especially of the first case. So, The question is whether you would repeat EUS in that pancreatitis case.
Well, probably in this case is that it's true that we perform the EUS during admission. Sometimes it's okay to come back after 4-6 weeks, as we have already commented, to see how is the evolution. More than to analyze the diagnosis that we already knew is how the patient evolved after the first episode. And probably we will schedule the case in 6 to 8 weeks. That is the perfect time to do an AUS after the acute phase of an acute pancreatitis.
Okay, another question said whether ductal drainage would be necessary. I think you have answered this before. No, not at the moment. And another comment was that there seemed to be no stenosis or stone. How do you exclude main duct IPMN? That's a good one.
I think it's almost impossible. It is true that the findings in the pancreatic parenchyma leading to a high probable diagnosis of chronic pancreatitis exclude a little bit the possibility of IPMN. Also, the rationale of the patient with heavy alcohol intake, former smoker, provides an etiology for chronic pancreatitis also. But it's true that there is only one way to exclude main duct IPMN, and that would be to do a pancreatoscopy. I'm not thinking on doing a pancreatoscopy in this patient in this moment, because it's not my main suspicion. I have here Jose and Danny, and we all both know the case. So in this moment, I will not suspect it, and I will, during the follow-up, since I'm sure we will come back either with an AUS, either with an MRI, MRCP, if in any moment that diagnosis stays there, we will think on doing a pancreatoscopy in this patient with a dilated duct. Not in this moment.
I think the most, maybe the most important thing is to have this diagnosis in the back of your mind when the patient comes back, and, you know, include it in your follow-up thoughts, because that's a tricky one. And there are people saying that the old literature ascribing a cancer risk to chronic pancreatitis might have been due to the fact that they missed main duct MPMNs. So that's, I think there was a very good comment. And I'm picking out the last question. Would you still recommend gallbladder removal for this patient?
The questions are quite complex. Okay, as I comment, this is the good thing of being just an endosonographer. You just place the diagnosis and you give the problem to the pancreatologist. But it's true that in this case, with an acute pancreatitis, although it's in the setting we believe in of a chronic pancreatitis, with such large amount of stones, definitely at least we will try to discuss with the surgeon the possibility of doing a cholecystectomy. So my answer is yes, I will discuss with in the MDT team the possibility of doing in this case a cholecystectomy. Yeah.
Okay, great. So let's go maybe to the next complex, or do you want to show the results of the poll before we go into therapeutics, maybe, that we know what our audience does and thinks?
Okay, so since I make the questions, we can take over, and I'm here with Jose and Danny, that we are lovers of AUS, and Jose is also an AUS and ERCP. He's our interventional guy. So in your practice, do you perform, it was only diagnostic, both, or just interventional AUS? Look, Thomas, we discussed during the discussion that you will not believe in doing just interventional AUS, but we have cases in which people only do interventional AUS. I realize that the most expected answer would be both, although here, for instance, I'm mostly doing diagnostic AUS, Daniel mostly doing diagnostic AUS, and Jose is mostly doing the therapeutic AUS, although we are starting, and in fact, Danny is now leading our unit on treating portal hypertension, and Jose is leading all the therapeutic HPV. So that's the first question. I think we can just have a brief summary of the answers, and then we can start the discussion with all the groups. Mm-hmm. So in case of interventional AUS, are you able to perform ERCP in the same session performed by the same operator? So 66% is yes, 33% is no. And the last question is AUS routinely used in your ERCP practice? So it's almost 70% yes and 49, no. Well, I think it's just showing what is going on in most of the departments in everywhere in the world, mostly, for instance, in Europe, and it's very much what we are doing in our center. I would deserve a word from Andreas, from Francesco, Serena, Thomas. What is your impression in these results?
Well, I think 10 years ago, it was probably just the other way around.
Yeah.
Andrea? What do you think?
Well, I'm always interested about this answer. I will first comment on the second one, because I would like to stress a concept. In case of interventional EUS, are you able to perform ERCP in the same session performed by the same operator? Two-thirds make yes, one-third say no. We should have been more specific in these questions, because to me, it's not so important that you have the same operator to perform both of the procedure. To me, it's much more important that you have a setting that allow you to perform both of the procedure in the same room, in the same session, and respective on the operator. Of course, from the ideal world, I would say I would prefer to have an interventional biliopancreatic endoscopy, everything in one piece, let's say.
But Andrea?
Yeah.
Andrea, I think the question is especially relevant when it comes to emergency procedures, because then you don't have the full team, right?
Oh, yeah. This is true. This is true. Although I would like to understand what is emergency procedure in biliopancreatic endoscopy. I know only one emergency procedure, that is severe cholangitis in a septic patient. And this is mainly treated by ERCP, and we still have problems in having even one guy that performed only ERCP on Saturday evening. So I think that the problem in that case is much more on another side. But yeah, of course, ideally, I would like to have everybody doing everything. But as we were discussing, this is obviously not possible, at least at the moment. Of course, 10 years ago, it was even more difficult. But nowadays, thanks also to the new generation that is coming, and we have seen here a nice operator performing both of the procedure, I think the future will be that. In the meantime, I think that the director of the hospitals and the director of the department should think about a nice organization with the possibility of changing the operator easily. This is my opinion.
But that, at the end, I think it calls for, you know, highly specialized units, so that you don't have EUS everywhere, ERCP everywhere a little bit, 50 yeah. procedures a year and two EUS interventions. So I think it has to be centralized.
Yeah, in order also to build a nice, let's say, teaching program. Yeah, this is very important, very important.
Well, okay, and about the third question, a brief comment
on interventional EUS. I think one of the changes for the guys that we do not perform ERCP, I don't do ERCP, is that the new devices that are EUS devices, like the Axios, for instance, brings the opportunity that is not an absolute need to have knowledge on ERCP, that you can do some of the interventional EUS procedures. So it is true that the development of new devices, specific AUS devices, makes not so important to face a pure therapeutic AUS procedure. Although it's true that the world is trending to have a combined ERCP and AUS guide. But okay, I don't want to bring another problem, that is the organization of it. That's another point.
But we're getting into an interesting fight, right? So. How much will EUS, interventional EUS, take away from the primary ERCP business? Andrea, do you want to defend ERCP or not?
Julio always make me laugh. You are incredible. is very nice because we have, you know, you can see the same thing from different perspective. When a guy that was born doing ERCP started saying that for doing interventional EUS, it's enough that you know to do ERCP and a little bit of EUS, all the endosonographers were getting angry. On the same way, when a guy that performs perfect EUS like Julio starts saying that I can do also drainage because I know pretty much about EUS and a little bit about X-ray, ERCPs, pure ERCPs get angry. I think, guys, that this is basically what is happening. What is happening? The two procedures are merging. Of course, ideally, the best thing is to be trained both on the same level, both on ERCP and EUS. But in the meantime, I think that we are ready to, you know, to be more, how can I say, more realistic. So I think that the most important thing is to have a nice unit to work. I would say to Julio, I would be happy to see you doing interventional EUS. Also because I know that whatever happened, you can knock on the door and you are in a nice department that can bring everything you need at the time.
That's Andreas, that's great because that's why I have Jose by my side. Jose is here and he's doing both. I mean, he's in Santiago, he's mostly doing the interventional EUS and ERCP. And what's your opinion? Because you started doing EUS, then you moved to ERCP, and now you do both. So do you, I mean, you're a believer of a combined technique, but at the same time, you work with me that I not do both combined techniques. So what's your impression on this discussion, on the next, that this is the future of EUS? This is where we are moving.
Okay, no, I do really believe that we should know about two procedures, about both procedures, and I do agree with Andrea in that point. From my point of view, it's mandatory to learn also ERCP and EUS, EUS and ERCP. But another important point that I would like to highlight is that perhaps this kind of procedure should not be performed in all kind of centers. So we should centralize all the attention of the patients in big centers because the probability of, for example, failing an ERCP, and in that sense, performing then an EUS is not so high. So you are not going to perform hundreds of interventional EUS procedures. So you have to centralize all this activity in high volume centers in order to get experience, in order to get a lot of experience in doing interventional EUS. And I believe that this is a crucial point.
Okay, guys, I think we have 10 more minutes or something. So the conclusion is A, centralized services, and B, either the same person does ERCP or EUS, or you have to have twins, like Siamese twins, where one does EUS and the other one ERCP, so like in Santiago. Okay, so let's talk about the sequence a little bit, because we have heard in Andrea's lecture that we have several procedures, and also Francesco showed us you switch from one to the other. You have ERCP, then you have enteroscopy for certain indications, and then EUS. So should the sequence be consider or try ERCP first? If it fails, and the anatomy is accessible to enteroscopy, then enteroscopy is the next, and the rest is taken by EUS. So let's ask the team from Rome. What's your sequence?
Yeah, to say the truth, enteroscopy is even if we got a good quality of equipment, we don't use so much because it's really time consuming and really difficult, and the success rate is very, very low. To say the truth, in our end. The literature doesn't say different things. We prefer to use EUS approach and then probably enteroscopy, but it's really rare, to say the truth. And for this reason, I don't agree so much with Julio when said that we have to looking for a specific device for each specialty. I think this is very important for a single operator skillness be able to use every device. So the experience in using the ERCP device is as a pivotal role in US, in therapeutic US. That's why we love to use the same device for both the procedure. And for the trainings, especially for the training, it's really important to be able to know and to use very well the device specific for ERCP, because we are, as we heard from Andrea, hepatobiliary pancreatic endoscopy. So you must able to use every device, and then you can translate this illness on the US. This is my personal point of view. Sorry.
Okay, I think it's the wrong group to, because nobody fights for enteroscopy. If we had invited certain people, they would now jump up and say, oh, we always reach there, etc. So I think it's highly individual, but I think for post-operative anatomy, where you might have to do repeated dilatations and you have a reasonable access, enteroscopy is a good choice. Because one thing I wanted to ask you about EUS access, we have all started with malignant indication. Now it gets to benign. So would you say, okay, we do a hepatogastro enterostomy, and then instead of having a permanent percutaneous access, we have a, not permanent, but for, let's say, 6 months, a temporary access instead of percutaneous, it's now the way through the stomach? Andrea? So PTCD is out, you do it now via even for benign disease?
Not at all, not at all to me. First of all, it's very important that you have a nice connection with surgeon, because whenever you go for interventional EUS, you need to have a connection with the surgeon, not only for the complication, but also for the next indication of the patient. If the patient has a surgical indication, maybe the hepatogastrostomy could be something that the surgeon doesn't like too much. For the choledochoduodenostomy, we have learned by the surgeon that they can perform the duodenocephalopancreasectomy, even pyloro preserving, even after biliary drainage with choledochoduodenostomy. But as far as I'm concerned, I know that surgeon doesn't like to have the hepatogastrostomy if they are going to do interventional. So I think that when we have to choose a solution, we need also to think about the pathway of the patient later on. And this is very important. So we may start speaking about HPB, not endoscopy, but HPB pathology, HPB approach, in which we need to think not only about enteroscopy, EUS, and ERCP, but also about surgeon and radiologist. The percutaneous approach could still play a role, also in helping us performing procedure in altered anatomy, when you need to do, you know, to approach a biliodigestive anastomosis. Sometimes you have to do, let's say, a gastroenteroanastomosis, and you need the approach from the radiologist in order to fill the gut to do the target, to target your stuff. So I still think that there is space for everyone, but the important thing is to understand where are you at the moment. You may be the best endoscopist, but if you are working in a place in which you do not have this facility, you have to think about. You need to think about the patient. Does the patient still have the gallbladder in, yes or not? Because this make a big change in choosing your solution. And what is the pathway of the patient later on?
Andrea, I love that comment because I think that's very, very important to liaise with other disciplines and to have the final therapeutic aim that you don't do anything and then something and leave a stent somewhere and then you are beaten up by your surgeon. So I couldn't agree more. And I was also trained, although I'm a gastroenterologist, my co-trainer was a famous surgeon and he taught me the question is which problems do we have to solve? Yeah, so that we don't have a solution and looking for a problem the other way around. This was, Andrea, almost a conclusion of the meeting, but we have a few more minutes, which I would like to devote to endohepatology. So back to the team in Santiago and Julio, they love the liver. There are other teams, Julio, saying, why replace a simple procedure, which is 100 years old, by, you know, an endoscopy with sedation? So what's your argument?
Well, I think the arguments are, first, that the quality of the samples that we are obtaining are starting to be very good, as Jose showed, and I hope we will have our study published as soon as possible. So you can really see that we can reach the high quality needed for the in the evaluation of a liver sample. That's point number one. Point number two, it depends also on the facilities. For instance, in Santiago, or almost any, if you go for percutaneous or any other place, you need to have, really? Danny has a lot of expertise in percutaneous ultrasound. Mm-hmm. So Danny, the need for the patient to stay in the hospital is a meaning of 6 to 8 hours after the procedure. But after a liver biopsy, we discharge in 30 minutes sometimes. So the time for the procedure is very short. And in the same procedure, we can exclude, as Jose showed us, any other potential cause of the elevation of liver enzyme. And it's not the first case that we schedule the patient for a liver biopsy, EUS guided. And for instance, we detect some other diseases that stop us from doing the procedure that was another potential cause of this alterated lab analysis. And then endohepatology. I mean, there is not only for the liver biopsy, we can access solid liver lesions. Now we can evaluate portal hypertension. There is some systems that you can access to the portal vein and make the measurements in a more feasible way than the classical transjugular approach. And then Danny is starting doing the, and you can deserve a word from you, Danny, to treat fundus varices, which is another potential role of therapeutic EUS that is more and more accessible now that we can put coils or either we can put glue. So
yeah, we can do in the same procedure, evaluation of portal hypertension, evaluation of biliary tract, evaluation of liver lesions. I think that it has a lot of advantage compared to percutaneous ultrasound. And I think that we are moving forward to perform all of this evaluation by US instead of percutaneous evaluation.
And I mean, we're endoscopists, okay? And we are gastroenterologists, and we need to increase our units. So which is the best way to increase our units to increase the number of indications for the US? So
and
taking into account that there is an absolute indication and AUS is considered one of the best tools in these kind of diseases.
And Julio, definitely you cannot do this with a duodenoscope.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
Okay, guys, before it gets weird, I get the challenges. Take the liver from the hepatologists and bring it into the home of the endosonographers. I think that's maybe a very nice end. I'm very grateful for all the teams. We saw fantastic cases. We had brilliant lectures. I think we could go on discussing probably till 8 o'clock, but we have to stop now. We thank you very, very much for your perfect contributions. We thank the sponsor. And, you know, we have shown that Fuji provides the full spectrum, as you have highlighted. What I especially like, and you Italians should like, is the name Arietta. That's, isn't that a little aria? So that's
fresh,
the perfect
air.
Fresh air. Arietta from Aria.
Yeah.
Ah, okay. So it's both the opera and the fresh air.
Yeah.
Good. Thank you. I expanded my limited knowledge of Italian. So thank you, everybody. And thanks to the sponsor. Thanks to the viewers. And I think we are finishing with an outro. Have a nice evening.
Thank you.
Bye-bye.